Good to see you as we come. Looks like it's basically a normal week. Whatever normal is anymore. In my world, normal comes with the prefix Abby. And if you remember Young Frankenstein, you'll remember that. Pardon me?
Frankenstein.
Well, let's just say that every day I am getting new energy and feeling better, and thank you for your continued prayers. That's what I have as I do have another one. And we have been talking since probably September about beginning to update our multimedia hardware and so on. I am putting together a team of people who would like to be a part of that. If you would like to be a part of that and help in that process, please let me know, because I am trying to model that we don't do things as a lone ranger, and therefore I do not want to do it alone. And I would love to have a couple of people work with me on both the design and then the implementation of it. So if you would like to do that, please let me know, because I'm not sure who likes to play with electronics and all those kinds of things yet. So that's the information I have this morning. Anything else, boss? No? All right. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Let us stand. Good morning, God.
Good morning, God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For letting us worship and praise your name. Let us join in singing.
We can trust God.
God is like a mountain, it's rock solid.
God loves all the people,
the poor, the disabled, the outcast, the stranger.
We can depend on God. God feeds the hungry, heals the sick, and restores relationships.
Praise our loving God. Hallelujah.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
Every moment of my wandering, that we often fall short of your call to love one another well. Help us to see your great generosity, hear your word of mercy, and feel your love for all who need your grace. Strengthen us to reach out in service to those who are in need. Make us aware of those outside our own inner circles of comfort, that we may see them as your precious children and serve them in humility and joy. May we continue to grow in grace as we learn how to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today's reading is from James 2, verses 1 through 26. My brothers and sisters, do you, with your acts of favoritism, really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus? For a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your assembly, and if a poor person in dirty clothes also comes in, if you take notice of the one wearing fine clothes and say, have a seat here, whilst you, the one with who is poor, you say, stand there or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs to the of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as a transgressor. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails at one point has become accountable for it all. For the one who said, you shall not commit adultery, also said, you shall not murder. Now, if you have not committed adultery, but you have murdered, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If your brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to him, go in peace, keep warm, eat your fill, and you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But someone would say, you have faith, I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I, by my works, will show you my faith. You believe that God is one? You do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. Do you want to be shown, your senselessness person, that faith apart from work is barren? Was not our ancestor Abraham justified by his work when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that faith was active all along with his work, and faith was brought to completion by the works. Thus the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness, and is called the friend of God. You see that a person is justified by works, not by faith alone. Likewise, was not Rahab the prostitute also justified by works when she welcomed the messenger and sent them out by another road? For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without work is also dead. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven.
Gracious God, we come to this passage and we hear a call in two directions. One, to look beyond the means of other people and to see them the same as we see ourselves. And that when it comes to our faith, that our faith is truly alive when we are serving you and the world around us. Speak to us now as your word speaks. Let these words, O Lord, be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It was during one of those times in the mid-70s that this story came to life. It was in a downtown church that was filled with people. It wasn't a post-COVID church. It was a church where everything was moving forward, everything was going well, and the pews were filled, and you had to get there early to get your seat. And it was time for the service to begin, and just as it was time for it to begin, a young man in holy jeans and a dirty sweatshirt came in with dirty long hair. Now, this was one of those churches where everybody came in suit and tie and dresses, and it was to the high side of society. And the young man walked in, and he looked at the pews, and he looked to see whether there was a place, and he saw that the only pew that was open was the front pew. Which is very typical. And so he walked down the aisle, and as he was walking down the aisle, all the people's eyes went to him. They all began looking at him, thinking, what is he doing here? Where does he think he belongs? Why do you think he thinks he belongs here? And he walked in, and he walked all the way down, sat in the front pew. And the ushers in the back were looking at him, trying to figure out what to do. And the head usher, who happened to be in his early 80s, took one look at him and began to follow him down the aisle. Now, the usher was dressed in a fine suit with a tie with the knot just right and a vest. It was a nice three-piece suit, and he came in, and he had his usher's tag that said head usher, and he began walking slowly down the aisle. And the people were nudging each other. What's he going to do? Is he going to get him out of here? Is he going to throw him out? Is he going to tell him he has to go sit in the back? And the old man just slowly walked down the aisle. And he kept walking. He got all the way down to the front. And everybody was expecting that they were going to see some kind of a confrontation, that he was going to grab him by the arm and pull him out or take him out. And he went in and he sat in the front pew right next to the young man and put his arm around him and said, "Welcome, child of God." And the congregation was not sure what to do when they looked and saw that this man who had been a pillar of the church broke all their rules by welcoming this man, this young man who was filthy and dirty and was out of place in theirs. And they questioned him afterwards. "Why did you go down and sit with him and put your arm around him?" And he goes, "Because that was me when I was a young man and came into a church that did not want to see me because I didn't know how to dress and I was not able to get the right bath and I did not know how to comb my hair." And the congregation was humbled by the man who was a pillar of society, a pillar of the church, who came down the aisle and welcomed his new brother. Where would you be in that story? Would you be the old man coming down the aisle? Would you be the young man coming and sitting in the front pew? Or would you be one of those in the pew saying, "Doesn't belong here"? You see, James talks about that and says, why are you looking at what somebody has? What are you looking at what somebody looks like? Why are you looking to see whether they've got the right jewelry or the right haircut or the right dress? Because the only thing that matters is what's in their hearts. Now, James was saying this because he was talking to not only the people in Jerusalem, but to the people in this letter who would receive this letter who were living in the Gentile areas around Palestine. And there was a lot in that early church of segregating the Jewish Christians from the Gentile Christians, and that there were the haves and the have-nots, and that there were those who were both acceptable and those who were not acceptable because they were seen as dirty. They were not Jewish in their faith. Well, to understand this a little bit more, we have to understand who James was. James, well, in the New Testament, we find that there are two James that we hear about. One is James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother was John, and he was one of the fishermen in the early time. And the other one was James that we hear about later in the Gospel of Mark, who is the brother of Jesus. And it is that brother, that James, that we believe wrote this letter because he became one of the leaders of the Jerusalem church, and he understood because not only did he know Jesus rather well as his brother, but he believed in what he was all about. He understood that they had to look beyond all the things that we see in the world to see into the lives and the hearts of the people that are seeking, or who don't know that they're seeking, or who need to know that they should be seeking, and help them find their place in the faith and in the kingdom. And so we come this day and hear in the beginning of chapter 2 that James is trying to correct an understanding. And he leads right from that into the second major issue that he has. Now, you have to put James' statements here in the second half of along with Paul to get a good understanding of what it means that faith without works is dead. Paul is all about motivation. Why are we doing what we're doing? What are we doing what we're doing? And James tells us that faith without works is dead. And he's not saying that we need to do works for the sake of doing works, or that we need to do works in order to earn God's grace, or to earn God's pleasure, or to earn God's acceptance. He's saying that the same thing that Paul is, but Paul puts it a little more eloquently in his writings when he's talking about the why of faith and the why of works. That the motivation that we need to have in our lives for the things that we do are for honoring God, because he has already honored and given to us new life. And that when we believe in God, that we are, when we turn that around and act toward other people in ways of lifting them up, we need to be seeing in our own lives and in our own hearts the reality that God acted first through his son Jesus Christ, and that all we can do is respond. John was a man in the Napoleon community who came to one of the people who was serving the interfaith shelter meal. Now, the interfaith shelter meal, the interfaith shelter was a homeless shelter that served a meal for anybody who wanted to come on Saturday afternoon. They had housing for some people, but the big thing was their meal on Saturday. And the Disciple Bible Study group then, in 1991, as their service project, decided that they were going to serve an interfaith shelter meal And they called and got all the information. They decided that they were not going to go in with sloppy joes. They weren't going to go in with hot dogs. They weren't going to go in with just potato chips and those kinds of things. But that they wanted to make sure that those who came had a real meal filled with healthy and fulfilling food. And one of the things that they did with that was they also said, what do the children drink? Oh, they drink powdered lemonade. Now, if you've ever had powdered lemonade, you know that it's a very fine line between that which is drinkable and that which is horrible. Because it either tastes like water that should be poured out, or it tastes so strong that it clenches your throat on the way down. And there's absolutely no nutritional value. And so they said, well, how many children generally come? And they said, well, there's usually about 30, 35 kids. So they brought 7 gallons of milk. And the director said, nobody's ever brought milk before. Well, they decided that after they fixed a full chicken meal with green beans and potato and all the stuff that goes with it, and the people were just excited. They said, we're going to do this again. And they've been doing it the third Saturday of the month since 1991. Now, I'm bragging on them. Because there's a group of people that have felt that that was their calling. But John came in one week, and he asked if he could help serve the meal. And he came in, and it was time to go and to prepare the meal, and they did that at the church, and they drove the 20 miles in, 18 miles into the interfaith shelter, carrying the food in the back of minivans, which usually meant that the vans had to be cleaned afterwards because of the spillage and all the stuff that was there. And they went in and he was there to help prepare, he was there to help drive, he was there to help serve, he was there to help, you know. We thought, wow, this is really nice that this guy who's not connected to anything, he just heard that we serve the meal. He came and did it. The next week, we began to hear from around the town that he was now in charge of the interfaith shelter meal, and he was doing the whole thing from the beginning to the end, and he was saying, look how good I am. And those who were there thought, yeah, you did a nice job, but you're doing this for your own glory. The rest of us do this to help feed because our faith tells us to help feed. And the motivation that he had as compared to the others who were there and serving the meal was that theirs was a result of their faith. Theirs was a result of faith without works is dead, and you offer yourself in the work of the church, in the work of service to the world around you, because God's given you a blessing to share with others. And that's what James is talking about. It's all about doing the work as a result of our faith. He said, tell me about your faith and you have no works. I can't see your faith. But I can do my works that's motivated by my faith, and you will see my faith. Paul reminds us that if we are working because God has blessed us first, then it will show in everything that we do. What is the difference? Well, don't forget to show your work. Now, my son Billy is a He's a biotechnological statistician, so big words for, he works at a company that does the pre-testing on drugs for the pharmaceutical companies, and he does the statistical work. But when he was a young boy, he could see everything in his math. He was doing math problems in his sleep at 4 years old. We'd go in, he'd be doing this, and while he was sleeping, we tried to figure out what was going on. He began his college math in sixth grade. I don't have that ability. He could see it. One of the things, though, that we had to teach and train him to do was to show the work. He could be given a problem and go, well, that's the answer down here. And he would just put the answer in. The teachers would keep coming back, yes, the answer is right, but how did you get there? Well, the problem's this, and the answer is this. And how did you get the answer? And he would see it so fast in his mind that he couldn't get to write it down. So we had to train him how to take the steps, to show the work, to go from the problem to the solution so that the work was being able to be seen. That's one of the issues that we need to be about in the life of the church. Not to say that we don't, it's to remind us that faith, when we live it out in our lives, comes to life and is seen by others, by the things that we do that are motivated by our faith. And to always be asking that question, what am I doing to let my faith come to life? Because if I'm not doing anything with my faith, James says that faith without works is dead. But he also says that works without faith is empty. Where are you on a regular basis? How do you live out your life? Where do you step out and say, you know what? This is where I need to be going. Or maybe it's, this is where I need to be going. Or maybe it's, this is where I need to be going. How do we find that? The first thing that we have to do with that, to find out where our faith is calling us, is to ask that question in our hearts and our lives. If there was anything that I could do to change the things around me, to change the things in the world, and I had the money and the means to do it, what would that be? What's that thing that I always wish that I could be doing? Because that is our passion. That is what drives us. That's what grabs a hold of our heart. And then we have to ask the question, what skills and gifts have God given me to be able to put that together, as well as who else can I draw in to working in that area, so that we can accomplish it? Because we don't need to do all these things alone. We need to find ways to bring others with us along the path. But when we take our passion with our gifts, it becomes our calling. And each of us is called by God to be in that place where He has gifted us uniquely. And it might be one of my passions is hunger. One of my passions is disaster response. In fact, if I had thought about it, if I hadn't been sick, we would be having Super Bowl Sunday today. And I'm not talking about S-U-P-E-R with the football. I'd be talking about S-O-U-P-E-R, Super Bowl Sunday, where we would be able to raise funds for hunger. by eating soup after the service. It's a wonderful program. It's worldwide. And the amounts that they make with that by people eating soup together is miraculous. And it is spurred on by our faith. But each of us has to ask that question. In my faith, what has God put upon my heart to say, I need to be working in that area? And in my faith, what gifts has God given me to be able to make that come to life? And what gifts and skills am I missing? See, oftentimes we don't do something because we're afraid that we won't have the right skills or the ability to do it. And so you go, well, if I could do that, if I had all the things in place, I would do it. Well, the issue is not that I can't have to do it alone, but that we call others in to compliment us. And then what do we do next? We do something. I love that song. I love that song, Do Something. When I got upset with God and I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. I created you. If not us, then who? If not me and you, then how? If not now, then when? Not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to put our faith to work. No matter what age or stage we're in, it might be a phone call or a note. It might be letting somebody know that we care. Or it might be going on a mission trip, or it might be helping in the Keep Kids Warm, or it might be working with the food shelters. It might be working in the Sunday school. It might be any of the many things that brings our faith to life. Because it's not enough to do nothing. It's time for us to do what?
Something.
Don't forget to show your work. Amen.
I have a Lord, see, and strive.
We have several concerns today, and I'll start with mine and as a thank you. I am actually this Wednesday headed to Africa to climb Mount Kilimanjaro. Yes, everybody looks at me a little strange that way. There's a fair amount of trepidation in my heart in it, but it's also I've prepared and going forward, so I ask the church to hold me in their prayers and concerns as I travel on a great adventure. So, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Thank you. The other thing on my heart that I wanted to, a lot of you may have noticed, hands in the air. I'm part of the Emmaus community, besides part of this church, and we are having a walk this September. And if any of you are interested in taking a step forward in your walk with God, please see one of us, our hands up. If nothing else, see me. Is a transforming place to help grow a ministry, and it has brought a great deal of joy to my heart. So, first one we have is from Stephanie, and it is for a friend. My friend who is struggling with depression, that she continues to listen for signs of God's love and encouragement. What a blessing. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
The next one is from Charlie Yeager and is for Jerome McCarthy, healing from shoulder surgery. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Next one is from Shirley Hicks. Next one is for Shirley Hicks. It's continued prayers for Chris. It's from Curly. It's continued prayers for travel for Chris and safe travels for Anne Marie. Lord, in your mercy. The next one is from Sandra Mead. And it's for Joyce Hebert. She is now on hospice care. She is now set at 95 years old. Thank God for a good life. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Next one is from Pam. She's for the victims of human trafficking. Super Bowl is one of the largest events of human trafficking that occurs annually. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
The next one is for our pastor. It's for Robin's sister, Sue Rabowski, has been put into hospice. Pray for comfort and prayer for Robin. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
I have a prayer from Cookie, for one that I just raised, for David McCartney. Safe travels and a great experience, and for families who have lost loved ones this week. Lord, in your mercy. I have one more from Barb Palamaki. It's for health issues for Stacy, Vance, John, and Eric. Lord, in your mercy. And we have one last one. My very good friend Dick is going to do that one directly.
Most of the time over the last many years, either here in the setting of our church or out in public when I run into you and many other friends in the community, been very gracious to ask a question over and over. How's your dad, who has been or has been 99 years old? And so a worthy question, and one that I'm always happy to respond that he's doing well, and that he is at the Jacob Eddy Veterans Home, and where I was seeing him on a regular basis, and we would communicate faithfully every day. And suddenly in the events of life, the answer to that question now is that Dad has passed away. And that happened this past Wednesday about noon. And so I wanted to tell you that. That's a lot more than can be put on a 3x5 card. And a couple of things that, of course, have been communication with people from all over the country. He's, of course, lived in Pennsylvania and spent a lot of time down in Florida and had many, many, many friends and other church families. And then I have my own family here. And on the moment of that announcement, there were many tears and much emotion. And my children were hurting over the loss of their grandfather. And so as a dad, I had to think of a way to frame that. And I said to them, and I have been saying to many other people, and perhaps a lesson that we can all take with us, that it is a good thing to cry and to mourn. It shows how much we love someone. And then, Dad, who had been in excellent health, as much as you can be at age 99, went into a severe downturn over the past weekend, and we had to instantly turn on a pain mitigating regimen and hospice and those kinds of things. And then in a few days after that, on Wednesday, as I said, he passed away in his sleep peacefully. And so I told my children, and I've told others who've asked, I said, let us give thanks that suffering was not prolonged, and that we were able to control it, and God was merciful in bringing an end to this long and wonderful life. And the third thing that I've said in framing this event is to give thanks to God for a wonderful life and a man who lived it so fully. We're going to, I hope that I will be able to do better on Thursday. We're going to celebrate that life mightily and talk about the man that he was. There was a lesson in the way he lived in all those many, many years. This Thursday at a memorial service here at the church, starting at 11 o'clock. So I hope that you and others will come and be part of that. And a very special message that I have actually prepared to talk about Dad and the way that he lived. So I wanted to share that with you, and I think that, well, we could say, Lord, in your mercy, I think that today I'd like to conclude that with God is good.
All the time.
Let us be in prayer. Heavenly God, we are thankful for faith. Lord, it is in faith that we are able to get through the things of life. And life is that time that we are called to live in preparation for living with you into eternity. And we come this day with many things on our hearts and minds, many issues in our world. We have joys and we have concerns. We have life and we have death. We have illness and we have health. And all of those things cause us to deal with the reality of life. And so we come this day and pray that you will surround our hearts with a sense of your presence, so that in whatever we do and however we do it, we may feel that you are with us. Let your spirit move among us today. As we come, touch each of us where we need to be touched, in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls. Transform us into the persons you would call us to be. Work within us to make us the new creation that you offered in your Son. And let us be the living example of your grace and your love through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray these words when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue to worship through the presentation of God's tithes and our offerings. As the plates are here and you have an offering, please bring them forward to offer them to Christ. Trust in you and return our gifts back to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Before we go into our song, just one announcement, and that is Lunch and Learn will not take place this Thursday because of the funeral that will be here. Just a note on that.
Thank you.
Go. Let your faith come to life. Go. Let your hands and feet show your faith. Go. Let God love your work as you love God.